you here. We have come to worship the Lord, to hear some incredible word today. So please stand with us. I have seen your faithfulness, God. You never break your promises. You are good, always good, my Jesus. Father, we come to you today to lift our hands and our hearts in worship, to just praise you, Lord God. We just want to thank you today. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let's go. Praise your name. Father God, we thank you. We come today to worship him on purpose. Yeah. It's a choice. And then to that choice, we get to put an action. And this song, I love, love, love this song. The battle belongs to our God. He is fighting for us. So what am I going to do? I'm going to lift my head in the battle and set my eyes on his face. My war cry is praise. I'm going to lift my hands to the heavens and call on his name because my war cry is praise. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for today. Hallelujah.
But never known defeat, who's never left a fight without victory, who is this King of glory? Our God so strong and mighty, the we
got to do. Lift our head in the battle and set our eyes on his face. And lift our hands to the heavens and call on his name. And when we do that, what happens? There's a calm that can come in and cover you. Because when we kneel down at the feet of Jesus, when we give it to him, it becomes a place of healing. It becomes a place of freedom. So we're going to lift our hands. We're going to praise our God today. Hallelujah. Worship comes the freedom, comes the healing. Father God, we praise you today for this opportunity to come before you in freedom to worship you, to praise you, God. Hallelujah. We have a song we're going to share with you today. And it's just kind of a little bit in my heart where I've been here lately. And that's where I feel like God wants us to just be in that place of worship, in that place, in his presence, at his feet. Because it's not about us. It's about him. Father God, we just worship you today. Hallelujah.
Take me back to where we started.
God, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you, to praise you. And more than anything that you can do, Lord, we just come today because we want you. Hallelujah. We just thank you and we praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. We did this song this week in our praise and worship practice, and we got excited. We fell in love with the message that that has. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I've done that more than once in my life. I'm sorry when I forget that you are enough. I don't want to be that person. I don't want to get stuck in that mode. So I'm just excited to be able to worship and praise him today. We are excited that you are here. We welcome all of our visitors. We're excited that you are here. We have a lot of good stuff going on today. Pastor Allen has an awesome message to share. Good stuff. Woo, woo. So right now, if our ushers would, we would appreciate if you'd pass out the white cards and tithing envelopes for anybody that would like one. They even have free pens. So go ahead and raise your hand. They'll give you a white card. What is a white card? A white card is a great opportunity for you to share a prayer request or a praise report, to go to Pastor Andy and Beth, to go to Pastor Allen and Miriam. You can even comment on how Sharpie looks today. He got a little bit of sun while they were out. Miriam says she did. They did. But at this point, as we prepare, we're going to have Pastor Allen come on up and share.
Hey, good morning. It's great to be back in God's house in Slodotna. All right. I told somebody this morning, I said, I can't sing all the verses to Johnny Cash's song, but we have been almost everywhere. We've been all around. But it's great, and we're just so grateful to see many of you back today. Last Sunday was 4th of July holiday weekend, and many of you were out playing holiday or whatever, or running a race or walking in a parade or whatever it is you were doing. And we're just glad you're here today to worship the Lord with us. And our ushers will be coming back in just a moment, but I love offering time. Offering time is a great time where we get to invest in God's kingdom. I grew up in church down in South Carolina, and my dad and mom always went to church. Dad wasn't always your most faithful Christian in his walk, but he hardly ever missed church. And Dad was probably the biggest giver in our church. And I remember one time Dad got upset with a preacher. Can you imagine that? And I mean, it's hard to imagine anybody getting upset with a preacher, but he did. And he said, I'm not going to give any more money to that church. I'm not going to give, keeping my tithes. I'm not going to give. And he quit going to church for a minute. It wasn't very long. And started giving his money to another church down the road about 15 miles away. But he always gave. It's kind of interesting. But the thing is, when a person gets upset with a pastor or upset with a church or upset with whatever, and they stop giving and stop attending, you're not doing the church any harm. You're actually harming yourself. Kind of like in my anger management, when I talk about that bitterness and that resentment, and when you carry unforgiveness and bitterness and resentment in your heart against another person, it's like you drinking poison and you waiting for them to die. Who gonna do that? But that's what that is, literally. They ain't bothering them. They're fat, dumb, and happy going on with their life. And you over here now draw it up in a knot. All mad at them. And then you see them and they're all smiling and happy and got a new girlfriend and you just get madder. And that don't hurt them. And so same way and I know things are different around here, and we're delighted to welcome all our guests watching today. And I know Pastor Andy, he and Beth family are watching down there. And I think I said this last week, but one of my our favorite movies, we've probably seen it 10 times, is a little movie called Finding Normal. It's a really cute little family movie. Your kids would love it. It's really cute, about a doctor who drives from L.A. to New York, and she gets pulled over in Louisiana and gets stuck in a little town called Normal. And she's not happy. And a little girl asked her, said, do you like Normal? And she's trying to be, diplomatic. And she said, well, it's different. And she looks at her and she says, well, different's not bad. It's just different. And so, things are different around here, I promise you, because I'm not Andy and Andy's not me. And things are different. He does things different. He's kind of weird, but not as weird as me. He's different, but not as different as me. And I'm just grateful that he allowed me to come back and be part and to share. So I want to challenge you to continue in your faithfulness and your giving, no matter what. And if you've been kind of, on the fringes and, I don't know, these things are different, just get over yourself and come on in here and get connected and pray for poor Pastor Andy. He called me one day. I'll tell this on him, and he's listening. I know he is. So, but he called me one day. Shortly after we'd left, been gone a few months. He said, man, there are days around here that I am so grateful to you. You've given me the greatest opportunity in my life, and there are days around here I want to drown you in the Kenai River. I just thought that was hilarious, and it's life, isn't it? Huh? Was it John Denver? Some days are diamonds, and some days are coal. Some days are great, and some other days really stink. And so, I just challenge you to make the best of it. But mostly today, I challenge you to be faithful. And I want to share one more little point before the ushers come. Dr. Linfield Crowder was one of my early mentor heroes. I had his picture on my wall in my office for many years. He was an Assembly of God evangelist. And he preached a sermon here in our church, Marlene, and you'll remember it, Steve remembers it, about tithing and giving. And it moved Duffy's heart in a way. He talked about it often. And I'm not going to get the whole thing, but one of the things he said is every time you give to this church, you're voting to keep the doors open. When you put, whether it's a dollar or $100 or $1,000, $10,000, when you give to this church, you're giving to keep the doors open. You're voting to keep the doors open. So when you don't give, you're in a sense voting for it to close. So I just want to challenge you to be a faithful giver all the days of your life. When things are going great and when things are not going great, be a faithful giver. And I challenge you to do that. Our ushers are coming and give you an opportunity to give today. Father, I thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your love, mercy, and goodness to us. We're just so blessed and so grateful to God for you, for all that you have done and all that you are even now doing. And Father, for all you're going to do, we're thankful. And I just am grateful for the opportunity, the privilege, and the ability to be a giver today. And we give. Bless every giver and every gift in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. Here's the awesome update.
To point a finger, we judge things from our point of view. The things that we say, the trouble it makes, it hurts you and it hurts me too. This is such a fallen world we live in. It's really not the way it's supposed to be. What if we could see it just love will change everything. We're all broken people. Don't we all need Jesus? Every moment of our lives, 24/365, our human is equal. Don't we all have our weakness? Hey. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody needs that grace. We all need Jesus.
Everybody needs a savior, even the ones who think they don't. We got stuff we hide deep down inside. There's so much that we don't show. Yeah, it's just the wonder world we live in. It's really not the way it's supposed to be. Isn't that the beauty of redemption? It changes everything.
We're all broken people. Don't we all need Jesus? Yeah. Every moment of our lives, 24/365, our human is equal. Don't we all have our weakness? Yeah. Everybody makes mistakes. Yeah, everybody needs that grace. We all need Jesus. From the beggar to the rich man, from the prison to the preacher, oh, all I know is we all need Jesus. All I know is we all need
Jesus. Woohoo! All right, the t-shirts are in. Theme this year, the t-shirts are in at the back, and they are so soft, which I know isn't going to impress you fellas, but it impresses me. I like it. Okay, so they're really good. Missy and her crew, which will change from day to day, but they're going to be back there. Friday night of the Destiny Conference is our t-shirt night, so we encourage you to get a t-shirt and wear them. It'll be great. It'll be fun. Because Destiny Conference is coming, okay? July 18th through the 25th. Starting on Sunday, there will be two services. Then Monday morning through Friday morning and Monday evening through Friday evening. It's a whole lot of church, and it is so worth it. Lots of great speakers, lots of great, incredible sharing that's going to be going on, good information for us. You have in your bulletin a golden ticket. The golden ticket is your chance to give to the conference. We need your help. Sometimes we just need somebody to help direct people to the t-shirts and to run back and forth and grab things, to go down and work in the children in the VBS in the evening for 15, 20 minutes or an hour or the whole evening if you could, or to go out to the camp and help set up for breakfast or dinner, or to help take it down. And yes, wash a dish. Do you know what an incredible gift washing a dish can be when there's only one other person out there doing it by themselves? You walk in and going, hey, I have an hour to give. Could I help you? If they cry, it's okay. That means they're happy. And you know what? Some of the best dishwashers are men. That's right. You guys can't get out of it. Even though sometimes I go back and correct some of his washing. He's good at it. I love every minute my husband does that. I know Pastor Allen's good at that too. He does that. It's a blessing. Okay, water baptism, the last Sunday of the conference. If you're interested, please write it on the white card or let Missy know so they have an idea of how many people are coming and wanting to do that. It is a great time. There'll be Duncan in the lake, and we'll be standing there cheering you on, and it's awesome. You'll be bringing, they'll let you know that when you sign up. There's important information for that. Ladies' luncheon, Tuesday, July 20th, $5 per person. Bring a guest. Our guest speaker is Barbara McGirt. She is the overseer's wife for the state of Alaska, BC. I think they call it. It's kind of all over. She's the one. My understanding is she's an incredible speaker, and we are so blessed to have her here. There is a sign-up sheet. Shannon or somebody, Jane, is going to be at the back cornering you because we want you to sign up. It's going to be after the morning service. It starts at 1 o'clock. It's going to be not very long. We have child care for ages 6 and under here at the church. The 4 to 6-year-olds are in question if we're going to have that because we need another babysitter. We need another person to come in and work with that group. From 4 and under, they'll be in the nursery. We have that covered. So if you know anybody or you have somebody willing to come in and help for that time, please let Missy know so we can get that signed up. It's important to have that blessing for moms to allow them to come to that. But please sign up. There's going to be an awesome lunch. VBS for the kids during the evening service. Laura Lee's not here right now, but Laura Lee has shared with Missy and I one of the awesome things they're going to be doing outside in the middle of the week, and we'll give everybody a heads up on that night, because otherwise we might be like, what? But it's going to be cool. It's going to be so much fun. We're going to wish we were out there. I hope that, who's Wednesday night speaking? He might be challenged to keep up with Laura Lee, okay? No. Not Kevin? No? Well, that's true. No, but he'll probably stop and have us join her is what I'm saying. It's going to be like. So they got a lot of fun, but they too need help. They need people to help. There's going to be a lot of kids in there, and they just sometimes need somebody to help be there, to help kind of corral so we don't lose any of them and to keep them encouraged. So please be a part and sign the golden ticket. We need your help. I think that's it. Hope you have a wonderful day. We have an incredible speaker coming. Pastor Alan Humphries.
Man, it's great to be back. All right. Hey, all right. I'm excited to get into God's Word today. If I can remember my password from my tablet. There we go. All right. Oh, man. Good to see you here. Good to see Larry and Mary all the way from Shelton, Washington. They drove up the Alcan and beat and said, we were probably in Arizona. So you flew. Oh, that's smart. Okay. Yeah, we did too. But it's great to be here. We have several other guests that are here, and we're glad that you're here visiting from wherever you're from. Oh, my, it is exciting. I want to share with you today a kind of a interesting lesson. It's kind of a review for some of you. Some of you probably going to be saying, oh, Pastor, not again. Okay, yeah, we've heard this before. Okay, I get it. But guess what? You get to hear it again today unless you decide, you know, you don't want to hear it. And you can, you know, do something different. But a little elementary, Watson. But it's going to be a little basics. But I think it's really what I feel like God put on my heart to do. And I wrestled all week in kind of getting this together because I wanted to share what God wanted and what I felt was the right thing to share, and we'll hopefully you'll be able to glean something from this. The Apostle Peter really encouraged me in one of his letters. He said, "It does not bother me to write this same thing to you again." So he's writing it again, and because I heard years ago that you have to hear something 7 times before you think about acting on it. So I just encourage you to open up your heart and be willing to listen today. And, you know, when I first came here, 34 years ago, 34 or 33, I can never remember if we passed, I've messed it up so bad, 87. So what was we here, 33 years or 34? I don't remember, but anyway, so it is what it is, right? Okay. Whatever it was, it was. But Miriam and I, and I think Barb Ratliff, the clerk at that time, took a class over at the college, KPC, in a class called MS-DOS. Does anybody remember MS-DOS? Okay, that was, Mike remembers, yeah. That was pre-Windows. It was the old school Bill Gates, almost said Bill Gaither. Bill Gates, it was his operating system, that disk operating system, DOS, Microsoft Disk Operating System. And you had to log into DOS and then go to your tree and find your files and then go down the file. You opened up the tree and you went to the file and you opened up the file and some more files popped up and you went down there and you got down here and you finally found your file and you opened it up. And when you closed it, you had to close that and close that and close that and close that and then go back to the tree and close that. It was a pain. But when Windows came out, you do the same thing happens today in Windows. You just don't see it because they bypassed all those steps and you just go to that and you, boom, you're over here. We also took class in Lotus 1-2-3. Anybody remember Lotus 1-2-3? Yeah, way back in the day it was the predecessor to Microsoft Excel. And then we took a class in Word. But we got all note up in on MS-DOS. And the thing that I discovered about MS-DOS is our brain works a lot like that. When we're thinking about something, and we go into a file of a thought. And then when we get there and we open that thought, it opens up a couple more thoughts. And then, boom, you go, okay, wow, yeah, I thought about that. And you go down that thought, and then pretty soon you go to another thought. And then pretty soon you're way off here where you did not start. And sometimes we can get stuck down there, just like in Windows. Folks could get, in MS-DOS, you get lost down here. And I can't get back to the directory, to the root directory. And you got to go through the steps. And in our brain, our thinking can do the same thing today. And I don't know about your mind, all I can base it on is my mind, but my mind can go some crazy places. Places that how in the world did I get here? My thinking. And the thing we have to realize is that I actually do have control over my thoughts. I can control my thinking. Now, I can't keep a bird from flying over my head, nor can I keep a thought from just entering my brain. But once that stupid thought goes to my brain, I don't have to open that file. Because once I open that file, then there's another one, and another one, another one. You know, when some idiot cuts in front of me in traffic, a file opens up in my brain. And that file got some ugly stuff in it. And if I go there, I can get in trouble. So I don't want to go there. I'll back the truck up and stay in my lane. Get back to my root directory, okay? So the same way in our thinking in just so many topics. So today I want to kind of cover some basic stuff. And it helped me when I first started walking with the Lord way back in the day. By the way, it was 50 years ago this month, or last month, June. 50 years ago in June when I gave my heart to the Lord. And 50 years ago since I touched a drop of alcohol, other than, you know, a NyQuil, or one guy gave me a piece of chocolate candy. It was not chocolate candy. It was chocolate candy, but it had all kind of other junk in it and lit me up. So, but you know, on purpose, taking a drink, it's been 50 years. So I'm very excited about that. But, and 50 years ago, this June, I met my lovely bride. And so it's been really exciting. But I want to cover a little basic principle today. So my first little point or two here is going to be just really basic stuff. But I want you to hear it. And if you're here with us today, maybe you're not sure where you are in your walk with the Lord. Well, this could be right down your alley. So, but for those of you who've already graduated high school, got your bachelor's, your master's, and your doctorate in Christian theology, just hang on, okay? Stay with me. It'll be a little basic, but you'll get over it. Okay. The Bible says in the most familiar verse probably in the entire Bible, John 3:16. The Bible says, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave His one and only Son so that everyone who believes in Him would not perish but would have eternal life." There's a key word in there, and that key word is, say it with me, everyone. One more time, everyone. So that everyone who believes in Him would not perish, but would have eternal life. Are you an everyone? Does everyone include you? If you say no, you need some help. Okay, everyone includes everyone. And everyone who believes in Jesus Christ as God's Son, believe that He died on a cross, that He was buried in a tomb and rose from the dead, everyone who believes in Him would not perish, but would have eternal life. Verse 17, God sent His Son Jesus Christ into this world not to judge the world, but to save the world. One of the songs that we sing, used to sing here, and we sang it, I think, well, Miriam, in fact, didn't you lead singing on Father's Day down in Aberdeen, South Dakota? And she sang this song, "It's a Good, Good Father." That's an amazing song. And one of the verses in that talks about that people say all kind of things about you. And they got different stories, but I know you're a good, good father. Let me tell you something. There's a lot of people got wacky, crazy ideas about God and what God did and what God did and this, that, and the other. But the reality is, God did not come in the world to judge you. He came in the world to save you. And you say, well, you know, God did this and God did that. And I said, no, God didn't do that. You did that with your stupid decision. Well, but God allowed it, yeah. God allowed, He gave us this thing called a free will. We watched a movie this week, by the way. You families, you would really enjoy this movie. It's called, I think it's called Walk, Ride, and Rodeo. It's about a true story about a young gal in Utah, Wyoming, Montana, somewhere in there, had a car wreck, truck wreck. She actually was riding in her truck to go to college. She just won the rodeo barrel racing championship. She's on her way, and her map's on the other side of the seat. She's out in Wyoming or somewhere Montana on a straight road. Well, that's one thing I miss about the Dakotas and Montana. Dude, the speed limit is 80 miles an hour. Yeah, man, it's awesome. And it's straight. This road's unbelievable. And it don't get slower when it gets curvy. It's just the mirror's over there holding on, white knuckling. And, man, it was awesome. But anyway, never mind. Okay, come back. This girl reaches over to get the map, and she can't reach it. She's driving down the road 80 miles an hour probably, and she can't reach it. So she unbuckles her seatbelt, and she crawls over her seat to get the map, and jerks the wheel. The truck flips and about 10 times, and she's thrown out of the truck, lands on a, and she's paralyzed from her waist down the rest of her life. And all of her rodeo dreams and hopes go out the window, and she's mad at God for God doing that. Duh. Well, God allowed it. Well, God allows a lot of stuff. God allow you to stay swimming in Lake Stupid as long as you want to swim in Lake Stupid. He's a good, good father. He loves us, but He loves us enough to not force us. He loves us. And He did not come. I don't care what stories you've heard or what your perception has been. God loves you. God will walk you through whatever mess. God did not come into this world to judge you and condemn you. Now, people will judge you. Say it ain't true. People will condemn you and criticize you, but not God. God loves you. I love John chapter 1, verse 10. The Bible says that Jesus Christ came into the world. John chapter 1, verse 10. It's coming. It's coming. Our computer person's a little slow up there today, but just kidding, just kidding. John chapter 1, verse 10. Expect something to come flying over the deal here any minute, okay? John chapter 1, verse 10. He came into the very world he created, but the world did not recognize him. He came to his very own people, the Jews, and even they rejected him. Oh, I love this next verse. I love this next verse, verse 12. But to all, say that word with me, to all. Say it one more time. All. Let's sing it together. All. Woo! One more time.
All.
Oh, man. To all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. To all. He came to the religious folks of the world of that day. And the religious folks of the world rejected him. Ended up hanging him on a cross. And you know why they hung him on a cross? Because he claimed to be Yahweh, Jehovah, Creator. They didn't hang him on that cross because they didn't like him. They hung him on that cross because he committed blasphemy and claimed to be Jehovah, Creator, Yahweh, God. And they killed him. And they rejected him. But to all who believe him, accept him, he gave the right to become children of God. And I am so excited about that because it gives hopes. It gives hope for a sinner like me. It gives hope to an undeserving wretch like you and me. And it gives hope because all are qualified. All we got to do is believe it. Yeah, but. No yeah buts. No yeah buts. Yeah buts don't count. Either it is or either if you believe and accept him, trust him, rely on him, accept him as your Savior, surrender your life to him as you understand him right where you are. If you do that, you have been given the right. That word right there is an interesting word. It literally in the Greek means authority. You've been given the authority to become a child of God. Well, I don't feel like it. It didn't say if you feel like it. It didn't say if you feel like it. After we retired and we got on from pastoring here and we got on the plane to leave, I didn't feel retired. In fact, to be honest with you, we have chosen to take that word retired out of our vocabulary because we're not retired. We're just transitioned to a different vocation. In fact, we have started a new little business, and Miriam came up with the name of it. I'm very excited about it, and we got a new Facebook group. You can follow us on it. It's where we're going to be putting most of our stuff that we do on it, and the little company is called Grow You 365. The letter U, Grow You 365, because that's what we want to do with the rest of our life is help grow you 365 days a year. So that's our mission, that's our vision, that's our dream, is to grow you 365. So go to Facebook at some point, not now, I mean, but go to Facebook at some point and like Grow You 365 and follow us, and it's going to be very exciting to see what God does with it. I have no idea. People say, you moved back. We didn't move away. We still live here. This is our home for now. Well, how long are you going to live here? How long are you going to live here? Nobody knows, okay? We don't know. You could be dead tomorrow. We could go to, you know, you don't know. I mean, I may get a call tomorrow to move to Hawaii. I'm going, okay? So I'm just saying, you know, if the opportunity comes, I'm going. I don't have to ask Miriam at all. She'll be packing while I'm praying. I mean, I know. I'm just saying God has accepted. If we'll just believe in him, accept him. And don't you believe the lie that you're not, but not for you. What's that song, Fear is a Liar? And one of the lines in that fear is a liar is you believe the lie that you could be the one that grace could never change. That's a lie. That's a lie from the dark side. You could be the one that grace could never change. That's not true. People ask me, well, how do I know, Pastor, if I've committed the unpardonable sin? If you had committed the unpardonable sin, you wouldn't be standing here talking to me about committing the unpardonable sin. You would be off in hate land and consumed with your anger and your bitterness and your resentment and not interested in God at all and turn your back on Him forever and no. So if you got any remote possibility of a desire to follow and serve God, you ain't there yet, okay? So let that go. Don't worry about that. I love this, verse 13. They are reborn, not with a physical rebirth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes only from God. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you believe that He died, rose from the dead, and you surrender your mess to Him, no matter how ugly your mess is, when you surrender your mess to Him, you are reborn. Not your body, not your flesh, not your mind, but your spirit is reborn inside. Now, I got saved, I accepted Jesus, but I don't feel any different. He didn't say you'd feel different. He said you would be reborn inside, your spirit would be transformed, and you would be a new person in Christ Jesus, and you'd be born again. The feeling may or may not come later on down the road, but you simply believe it by faith, and we accept it, and that physical, that spiritual birth takes place. Let me hurry. I love this next couple verses. This really helped me so much in my early walk with the Lord. Romans chapter 8 verse 1. If you have not memorized this verse, I would highly encourage you to memorize it. And now know that I'm speaking to you as if you were already a Christian. If you aren't, now no better time than today, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But verse 1, Romans chapter 8, is talking to Christians. Not talking to unbelievers. He's talking to people who accepted Jesus as your Savior. Babies you may be. You may have done it this morning. You may do it today. He's talking to you. I love this verse. It says, so now, there is no condemnation for those who belong to Jesus. The word condemnation literally means judgment awaiting. So there is no judgment. Judgment in the sense of condemnation to hell. There is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. Well, why do I feel condemned? Well, here's the thing. A lot of times we confuse, especially early in our walk with the Lord, we confuse conviction with condemnation. When you become born again, when you accept Jesus as your Savior, I always like to say it like this, South Carolina word, you weren't for sinning. When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you really surrender your life to Him, you is weren't for sinning. That means you're bad. You're going to be a bad sinner because you ain't going to enjoy it. You can go on back and do stupid. You can go on and lie and cheat and steal and go back and do this or do that or whatever, but you ain't going to enjoy it ever again like you used to. You're right. And a lot of people, when they come to the Lord, they really get born again and they get saved and they go back out in sin. They get depressed. Yeah, you bet. Because you know you're back doing stupid. And you know God don't want you doing stupid. And you feel this condemnation, but it's not condemnation, it's conviction. And so it's really important that you figure that out, what the difference is. If you're doing wrong, conviction comes in, not condemnation. You say, well, I've done so bad, and boy, the devil just is so good at this, heaping it on. You've gone too far now. You've already committed the unpardonable. You've done all this. You're not worth saving. You can never come back. And all those are lies. Because once you're born again, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who belong to Christ Jesus. I mean, either you is or is you ain't. Well, I accepted Jesus as my Savior. I believe I was saved. But boy, I went out and I did all this stupid stuff. See, here's part of the problem. We get saved from our sin, but we don't get saved from our habits. You still got the same old stupid habits. And here's the problem we pray. God, take this habit away from me. He didn't give it to you. You acquired it on your own. And you're going to have to deal with that habit on your own. Now, not on your own. He'll help you. See, he gives us the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit that comes inside of us, the Greek word for the Holy Spirit, Jesus, I'm not going to leave you orphans. I'm going to give you another comforter. That word comforter is the word paraclete. It's the Greek word and literally means to take hold of with us. So God gives us the Holy Spirit to come alongside of us. Come up here, baby, help me right quick. Come up here. She be the Holy Spirit, because sometimes the Holy Spirit does sound a lot like her. And that voice of the Holy Spirit in my life, it sounds a lot like her voice. And the Holy Spirit comes along, and I could say, you know, I really would like to pick that book up. I would like to pick that book up right there. I'd like to pick it up. Would that be all right? Yeah, would that be all right if I pick that book up? I want to pick that book up. I really do. Okay. Go ahead, you pick it up. Okay. All right. I'm going to pick it up. Put your little hand right down there with me. There you go. Okay. She picked it up with me, but she wouldn't pick it up. And neither, thank you, darling. And neither will the Holy Spirit pick it up for you. But he'll help you. And he won't help you lay it down. I mean, he won't lay it down for you. He'll help you. But habits are the thing that we often get stuck in. And we say, God, take this habit away. God said, I'm waiting on you, Jack. I'll come alongside. See, that's the beauty, and that's the thing I love about the AA and NA, the 12-step program, is that those 12 steps are designed to help you change your habits. Steps 1 through 5 will help you to get rid of the garbage and clean out the closet and dump all the trash. But steps 6 through 12 will help you to keep it out, to help you to do the whole make amends, the whole forgiveness, the whole cleansing. And by the way, they're all 12 right out of the book, the Bible. There's the big book, and then there's the big book called the Holy Bible. And the big book came, most of it came out of the 12 steps came out of the big book. And awesome principles. But like anything else, it only works if you work it. Well, but I want God to do it. Sorry. God will help you. But you're going to have to make that choice. But no matter what you do, there's no condemnation. There's no condemnation if you belong to Christ. Conviction, yes. Oh, I learned to separate. Oh, we got to go to verse 2. This one is amazing. And because you belong to Jesus, belong to God, because you belong to God, the power of his life-giving Spirit, the Holy Spirit, has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. When I was a kid, we had a black comedian that was real popular on TV. His name was Flip Wilson. Some of y'all old folk remember Flip Wilson. And my dad's store, we had a little rag doll. It was a Flip Wilson rag doll. I wish I had one today. They're pretty amazing. But on one side was Flip Wilson, and you turn it over, and the other side was Geraldine. That was the lady character he played on his show. And just so happened, Geraldine was my mother's name, so that was kind of funny. Remember that. But it was one of those talking dolls. You pull the string, and you know, some of you know his famous line. You pull that string, and he'd say, help y'all, the devil made me do it. Devil, once you become a child of God, the devil ain't got the ability to make you do jack. He can't make you do nothing. You can blame him if you want to, but what my old friend John says, that if I could kick the person most responsible for my problems in the butt really hard, I wouldn't be able to sit down for a week. We are our own worst enemy. We can blame the devil, but this verse tells me right there, because I belong to Jesus. Well, I'm about ready to have a runaway here. I'm telling you, this is exciting. Because I belong to Jesus, the life-giving power of His Holy Spirit has freed me from Lake Stupid. From the power of Lake Stupid. Now, whether I go back to Lake Stupid is my choice, but He's freed me from the power that sucked me back in. It don't have the power to suck me back in. Now, I'm going to tell you, if you want a cup of coffee, don't go to Maverick to get a cup of coffee. Don't go to Snake Bit Charlie's to get a cup of coffee. Stay out of them places, okay? That's your job, my job. That's our job. We've been free. See, verse 3, the law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent His own Son in a body like our bodies of us sinners. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving His Son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this, verse 4, so that the just requirements of the law would be fully satisfied for us who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. See, that eliminates that need for you to say, well, I'm not good enough. No, you're not good enough. You stink. You're a dirty, rotten sinner. So am I. You're not good enough. You'd never be good enough. You ain't good enough to be good enough. On your best day, you ain't good enough. I got news for you. On his best day, Billy Graham wasn't good enough. Jesus died to fulfill all those just requirements. Jesus took care of the good enough for me. He died in my place on that cross, but I got to receive it. I got to be willing to come to Him, and that dirty S word that we struggle with, surrender. I ain't surrendering to nobody. Sorry about that. You'll never get it. You never get it. We got to surrender. Wow. Oh, I wish I could open up your brains and pour this in. To understand all who believe Him and receive Him get to go to heaven. And we are free from condemnation. Now, we're free from God's condemnation. I wish we were free from religious people's condemnation. But I want to challenge you to hear Jesus when Jesus said, don't criticize and condemn others or it'll all come back on you. You know, as a pastor, I had to develop early on in my ministry what a friend of mine called thick skin. A soft heart, but thick skin. Because as a pastor, I had to, and I learned this early on. As a pastor, I got to be willing to take the roses with the tomatoes. And I don't mean tomatoes sliced on a plate. I mean tomatoes thrown at me. Because it's human nature. When we do something somebody else doesn't like or approve of, we're going to get a tomato. Now, we may not get it, but they just throw it at our picture when they're talking to somebody else. Well, Pastor Allen, I can't believe you did that. And I know that when I left here, I became the target of a lot of stuff. Because I know I didn't do some things, as good as Pastor Andy does. I know I did a whole lot of things better than he does them. But I did a lot of things that were not up to his standard, his quality. He's going to do them a whole lot better. You know what? That's awesome. That's wonderful. It's the way it should be because it's different. It ain't bad. It's just different. It ain't bad. What I did wasn't bad, it was just different. Now, I did some stupid stuff, or I didn't do some stupid stuff I should have done. There's a whole lot of list, but it's not your job to judge me. Thank God. Exactly. Thank God. Thank God. It's not your job to judge me. And even God, let me tell you, give you a clue. Even God himself don't judge people till the end of their life. God's not going to judge you till the end of your life. After you draw your last breath, and if there's any judgment, but really, he's not in the judging business. He's in the loving business. Well, but don't you know that? There's a lot of stuff you ought not do. There's a lot of stuff I ought not do. A lot of stuff all of us ought not do. And we're growing to learn what those things are. And when you feel that conviction in your heart, stop it. Stop. You know. I ain't got to tell you what your sins are. You know when you're doing stupid. When that person cuts over in front of you and you give them your IQ, you know better. You know you ought not do that. You wave at them with one finger. You know better than that. You ought not do that. You know it's wrong. Just stop it. Well, but I just couldn't help it. Yes, you could. You just got a habit. And you let your habits kick in. So, well, I'm just a jerk. No, you're not a jerk. You just got a habit of being a jerk. Quit it. Stop it. Quit making excuses for you're stupid. At whatever level it is. Start learning to build. Okay, I gotta quit. I gotta hurry. Galatians chapter 3. I got 10 minutes. Okay. Galatians chapter 3. I love this. Okay, I'm gonna change gears a little bit here, so stay with me. There's a whole lot I really struggle this week in trying to weasel this down because there's so much. I wanted to read the whole chapter 3, but I couldn't because time. But it talks about sin and works and how that our works don't justify us, that we don't get to go to heaven because in this verse passage it's talking about circumcision, but it's talking about obeying the law, doing rights and wrongs. And, you know, you can keep all the rights and wrongs and do all the good stuff, but that's not going to get you into heaven. What gets us into heaven is faith in God. Okay? And he clarifies it here. In the same way, verse 6, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as a righteous man because of his faith. So God called Abraham to leave his family, and what did God do? What did Abraham do? He left his family. He said, come and follow me, and I'll show you where I want you to go. He went and followed God. I mean, he got his wife and his possessions, his servants, got a whole flock and herd, and he took his nephew Lot and his stuff, and they migrated across to Canaan, to a land where he'd never been and didn't even know existed for sure. He didn't have maps back then. He said, I'm going to show you. Abraham's faith caused him to take action. And he said, Abraham's faith, he got counted as righteous. I love verse 7. The real children of Abraham are those who put their faith in God. Now, he's talking to a bunch of Jewish believers here, and the Jews believed they were children of Abraham. And still today, there's a lot of people who are Jewish, and in fact, I've met some Jews, quite a few in my lifetime over the last number of years, that are Jews, but oh my Lord. They are liberal beyond imagination. They're pro-abortion. They pro-this. They pro-that. They believe in. It's unbelievable. They're Jews by birth, and maybe Jews by religion, but we're talking Jews by faith. And God said that the real children of Abraham are those who put their faith in God. If you have accepted Jesus Christ, now you may have a hard time with this, but hang on. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, according to my understanding of this verse, you are a real Israelite. You can say, I am an Israelite. I'm a Jew. I'm an Israelite. I'm not a Jewish religion, but I'm an Israelite. I am adopted by faith in God. Let's read on. Verse 8. What's more, the Scripture look forward to this time when God would declare the Gentiles, that's me and you, to be righteous because of their faith. God proclaimed this good news to Abraham long ago when he said in Genesis 12, verse 1, all and 2 and 3, all nations will be blessed through you. So look at verse 9. Here you go. There ain't no room for question in verse 9. So all, there's that word again. Let's do it together. Sing ye.
All.
So all who put their faith in Jesus Christ share the same blessing. Listen to that. The same blessing that Abraham received because of his faith. Often I hear people say, well, you know those Jews, man, they're God's chosen people. They're blessed. Everything they touch turns to gold. They're just blessed. Duh. Hello. Read the verse. All who put their faith in Christ Jesus share the same blessing Abraham received because of his faith. You got faith? You believe in God? You accepted Jesus as your Savior? Give me a Presbyterian amen.
Amen.
Okay, Presbyterian amen. Shake your head, okay? If you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you surrendered your broken mess to him, give it all to Jesus at the foot of the cross, and you got faith, you got the same blessing that I got. I'm blessed. I'm blessed and highly favored. You know what? That makes some people so mad. I just love it. That pastor, you can believe the stuff has come back to me that people said about me in this town over the years. You know what? It's okay. It's okay. My only downside is I just wish I had all the money people think I have. I wish I had what some people think I got. But I'm telling you, make no mistake, I'm blessed. And so are you, if you want it. If you want it. Randy, you're blessed. You're blessed. If you want it, if you put your faith in God, and you take care of business. I gotta hurry. Verse, where am I at? Okay, jump down to Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Jesus, the Bible says, Paul writing to Christians, says, you've been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. I am free, free, free. Thank God I'm free from drugs, free from alcohol, free from sexual addictions, gambling. I'm free, 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 free. Thank you, Jesus, I'm free. I am free, but I am not allowed to use my freedom to satisfy my sinful nature. What God's called me to do is to use my freedom to serve you in love. And not just as a pastor, every one of us. Every one of us are called to serve in one another in love. Every one of us as believers, we're called to serve one another in love. I often talk about pastors, and it's so true, pastors, but not just pastors, all of us Christians. But a lot of Christians would rather be the captain of their own canoe than they would a maitre d' on a cruise ship. I want to be my own boss. I want to have my own canoe, and I'm going to make my own life. I'm going to run my own. Well, that's cool, but how many people are you impacting? What difference are you making in your world paddling your little canoe? How much more influence could you have if you was a maitre d' on a cruise ship? You'd be serving people, but you'd be how many people lives could you touch? Unbelievable. And God's called us as believers to serve one another in love. You're not serving Pastor Andy in this church. You weren't serving me in this church. You're serving him. And everything we do in serving one another, whether it's hold a door open for a saint, somebody to walk into Fred Meyer's or the bank, or pushing the cart over to the deal for some lady, or helping an old lady cross the street, whatever it is, we're doing it as unto the Lord. And that's what it's called all of us to do. The whole law, verse 14, look at this. The whole entire Jewish law, all the regulations, restrictions, requirements, all of them can be summed up in this one commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. Don't get caught up in how religious you're not. Don't get caught up in all the mess that you're not. Get caught up in serving your neighbor, loving your neighbor. We were talking earlier about, we did Mark Chapel's memorial service yesterday, and it was one of his neighbors that were there at the service, and they were neighbors. They cared for him. They cared. They neighbors, I mean, just, that's the whole Bible. Don't be waving the Christian flag if you ain't loving your neighbor as yourself. If you're a jerk, tell people you're atheist and help us in reverse. Be a servant. And that's what God called us to do. Verse 15. But if you're always biting and devouring one another, look out. Be aware that you'll destroy one another. I want to skip down to the last portion of Scripture, and I'm going to close with this. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Ephesians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says, therefore I, a prisoner for serving the Lord. Yes, he was in jail. He was in prison. He wasn't in jail. He was in prison for serving the Lord. And he's writing this letter from prison, and he says, I beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling. For you have been called by God. Some of you I saw today for the first time. After this service is over and we all leave, you may go back to wherever you came. I may never see you again. But I plead with you, if you're a Christian, if you've invited Jesus Christ into your life, please choose. I beg you, Paul said, choose to lead a life worthy of the title Christian. And when you blow it and you feel that conviction, repent and go invite, ask God to forgive you. Maybe you need to go to that person, make amends. That's why make amends is there. And the 12 steps, huge about making amends. Go on your sin, go apologize. I never will forget, Frankie and I were walking around one year at the walk, the cancer walk, and he saw this guy. I won't call no names, but he saw this prominent individual, and he just left me and went straight over to that guy and had a conversation with him. He said, I need to go apologize to that guy because I had really trashed him bad, and I was mad at him, and I said something. It's called making amends. It's called living a life worthy of our calling. Own it, and get rid of it. My friend Gene McConnell says, you can't heal what you hide. Get it out. Deal with it. Live a life worthy of your calling. Verse 2, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other. Make allowances for each other's faults because of your love. Stop judging, condemning, criticizing, gossiping. Stop it. Make every effort, verse 3. To keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body, verse 4, one Spirit, just as you've been called to being one glorious hope for the future. There is only one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father who is over all, in all, and living through us all. You know, I can almost look down the street and see the Baptist church right down here. And across the street's the Methodist church. Down here is another Baptist church and a Nazarene church behind him. And right down here is the Catholic church right down here. You know what? I got brothers and sisters in every one of those churches. They're all not as enlightened as you and I. But they love Jesus. And we got one God. They ain't but one Jesus. They ain't a Baptist Jesus and a Catholic Jesus. They don't work that way. They ain't a Pentecostal Jesus and a non-Pentecostal Jesus. It don't work that way. Assembly of God don't have a Jesus, and Church of God got a Jesus. It don't work that way. And those who think it does, beware. That's the fact. That's the mark of a cult when they tell you they're the only ones going to heaven. Run, Forrest, run. Okay, when they tell you they're the only ones going to heaven, everybody else is not, you know, out there, you know, well, you know, because they fly that stupid rainbow flag, you're all going to hell. You know, don't get caught up in that stupid. Stop judging. Just start loving. Let the love of Jesus flow through you. Miriam's song. and serve one another. Now, as I close today, for the third close, I want to challenge you. If you don't know the Lord, if you've never really surrendered your life at the foot of the cross, and you've never really invited Jesus into your heart and life, I want to challenge you to do that today. It's not rocket science. It's very simple. And all we do is pray a simple little prayer in faith where you are right now and mean it from the bottom of your heart and let God take the rest of it. Would you stand with me? Every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment. If you don't know the Lord, today's a great time to get to know Him. And maybe you've wandered and you've got off and stupid and you want to come back. It's easy peasy. All you got to do is pray this simple little prayer with me. And if you, everyone can pray it out loud. It wouldn't hurt all of us to do that. And just simply pray this little prayer. And it's not exact. It's just as best I know. But simply say, Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner. And I know I have sinned and messed up. And today I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Master. I surrender all my mess to you. I give you my life. I believe with all my heart that Jesus Christ is God. That He lived, He died, and He rose from the dead to pay for my sin and give me a new heart and a new start. Thank you for forgiving my sins in Jesus' name. Father God, I thank you for everyone that prayed that prayer today. And I just pray that you'd speak into their heart and let them know, God, that you love them, that you've forgiven them, and that you have given them a brand new heart and a brand new start. And Lord, I pray that they would make that commitment to learn, to grow, to deal with the stuff they need to deal with, to work the steps, to work the process, to grow, to learn, to make amends, to become the men and women you've called us to be. I thank you for it. And Father, I ask that every one of us would honor you in everything we do. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming. Someone's at the back with a clipboard for the ladies' ministry. And don't forget to show up next week at Destiny. It's going to be awesome. Next Sunday morning, Kevin Goff, right here in the house. Kevin Goff, and then I'll be speaking on Thursday night, and great speakers all week long. Come join us. God bless.